Everyone, the topic of today's lecture is sexually transmitted diseases. In this picture, you can see the conversation between two persons regarding sexually transmitted diseases. So you can see that the first person is saying, "How can I be negative when my partner tested positive?" To this, the second person says, "You have just been very lucky. Hope you understand that it is actually very unlikely that if someone is a partner to a sexually transmitted disease patient, then if he is spared." So sparing of the person who is a partner to a sexually transmitted disease patient is very unlikely. The name itself says so. But STDs can be prevented if you talk, test and treat, and that we will discuss through today's lecture. So at the end of today's class, students will be able to explain the terms sexually transmitted infections, reproductive tract infections, sexually transmitted diseases, discuss the epidemiological determinants and clinical spectrum of the STIs, and ultimately illustrate the diagnosis and management of STI and RTI using the syndromic flowcharts. So, first let me talk about the differences in the different terminologies like STIs, RTIs and STDs. So, not all sexually transmitted infections are reproductive tract infections, and not all reproductive tract infections are sexually transmitted infections. Sexually transmitted infections refers to the way of transmission, whereas reproductive tract infection refers to the site where the infection develops. So STI refers to the way of transmission, whereas RTI refers to the site where the infection develops. What is reproductive tract infection? So reproductive tract infection is a broad term that includes sexually transmitted infections as well as other infections of the reproductive tract that are not transmitted through sexual intercourse. So in this figure, you can see that the reproductive tract infections can be sexually transmitted, as well as we can have reproductive tract infections which are not sexually transmitted, like the bacterial vaginosis or candidiasis, postpartum, post-abortal infections, and infections following the procedures like intrauterine devices. The sexually transmitted infections which are also the reproductive tract infections, like gonorrhea, chlamydia, syphilis, chancroid, human papilloma viral infections causing warts, and herpes simplex virus. Now, in this circle, you can see that the sexually transmitted infections. But here, not all sexually transmitted infections are the reproductive tract infections, like HIV. HIV is not particularly a reproductive tract infection. Similarly, hepatitis B, oral RN sexually tract infections. These are not reproductive tract infections. So we can have sexually transmitted infections that are not the reproductive tract infections. Reproductive tract infections are the infections of the genital tract which can affect both male and female and caused by bacteria, viruses and protozoa. I already told you that they can be transmitted either through the sexual route or through the non-sexual route. So in women, generally the outer genitals, vagina, cervix, uterus, tubes or ovaries may be affected. In case of men, penis, testis, scrotum or prostate may be affected. Remember, reproductive tract infections or RTI may be acquired or spread through three routes, that is sexual transmission, or it may be endogenously acquired, or it may be iatrogenically induced because of some transcervical procedures or following the post-abortal procedures. So you can see in this figure the signs of sexually transmitted infections or the reproductive tract infections in females and males. In females, affecting it may affect the fallopian tubes, uterus, cervix, vagina, and the external genitalia. In male, it may affect the spermatic cord, epididymis, urethra, and the testis. Sometimes penis and the scrotum may also be affected. So now we talk about sexually transmitted diseases. Then what do you mean by sexually transmitted diseases? Sexually transmitted diseases are group of communicable diseases that are transmitted predominantly by the sexual contact, and they can be caused by a wide range of bacterial, viral, protozoal, fungal agents, and even ectoparasites. So what you have to remember, that sexually transmitted diseases are predominantly transmitted through the sexual contact. And now there are some changes in the terminology. Previously they were called as venereal diseases. Then this, because of the stigma associated with this name, this was shifted or changed to sexually transmitted diseases. Now even this name, this has been replaced by another standardized term which has been proposed by WHO, that is STI. Why? That we shall discuss. What is STI? Actually, this is based on the concept that somebody can have an infection without having the disease. So STI is a new term that is used to indicate that infections caused by microbes may not manifest as symptoms and do not always result in a disease. The common symptoms of STIs can be vaginal discharge, can be genital ulcers, can be urethral discharge, or can be abdominal pain, etc. So sexually transmitted infections are predominantly spread by sexual contact, including the vaginal, oral, and anal sex. So some of sexually transmitted infections or STIs can be spread via blood or blood products. And some STIs may also be transmitted from mother to child during pregnancy and childbirth. So what's the difference between STI and STD? Why STD has been replaced by the term STI? So a person can have a sexually transmitted infection without having obvious manifestation of the disease. And you know, whenever somebody is having a terminology like disease, suppose say for example Addison's disease, a Crohn's disease, the term disease has got more stigma attached to it. So if we say like I'm having urinary tract infection, or I'm having certain ear infection, so that doesn't sound that stigmatized. So this term sexually transmitted disease was replaced by sexually transmitted infections by WHO, and this STI became the standardized term. So two reasons. Number one, that not all STI infections lead to the manifestation of disease, and number two being that the social stigma attached with the disease term. So disease replaced by the infection STI. So now the general term or the standardized term that is used is STI. So when we use the term STI/RTI, we mean we try to highlight the term importance of STI within the reproductive tract infections, because the sexually tract infections actually are associated with more severe health outcomes or consequences than the RTIs. Another important thing is that these reproductive tract infections are considerably increasing in magnitude, but they are underreported. So to increase the reporting, RTI has been integrated with the STIs. But whenever the information is relevant only to STI, the term STI has been used alone. So now coming to certain key facts about sexually transmitted infections and reproductive tract infections. So more than 1 million sexually transmitted infections are acquired every day worldwide. Each year, there are an estimated 357 million new infections, with one of four STIs, chlamydia, gonorrhea, syphilis, and trichomoniasis. So the majority of the STIs have mild symptoms that may not be recognized as an STI or have no symptoms at all. So sexually transmitted infections such as HSV2 and syphilis can increase the risk of HIV acquisitions. Next, the drug resistance, especially for gonorrhea, is a major threat to reduce the impact of sexually transmitted infections worldwide. And another important thing is that STIs and RTIs are among the most important cause of perinatal and maternal morbidity as well as mortality. Now, there are certain serious complications of sexually transmitted infections and reproductive tract infections like ectopic pregnancy, pelvic inflammatory disease, preterm labor, miscarriage, stillbirth, congenital infection, infertility, cervical cancer, and even death. So here we can see the complications of sexually transmitted infections or reproductive tract infections in females, like this pelvic inflammatory disease, female infertility because of the blocked fallopian tube, and ectopic pregnancy, and sometimes even the cervical cancer. So next we talk about the epidemiological determinants. First one being the causative agents. So more than 30 different bacteria, viruses, parasites, etc. are implied for the causation of sexually transmitted diseases. Out of these, 8 of the pathogens are most important and they are actually responsible for causing the greatest incidence of sexually transmitted diseases. So among these 8 pathogens, 4 of them are generally considered for curable type of disease, whereas the other 4 are generally considered to be incurable. So which one is incurable? So you can see these are mainly the viral infections. The curable one can lead to syphilis or gonorrhea, chlamydia, trichomoniasis, and the other 4 pathogens which are incurable, they might be hepatitis B, herpes simplex virus, HIV virus, and human papilloma virus. But mind it, if we provide the treatment, then with the treatment, even those incurable ones, the symptoms of the disease may be decreased. So in this table, we can see the classification of the sexually transmitted disease agents based on their classifications, like bacterial agents, viral agents, protozoal agents, the fungal agents, and the ectoparasites. So in this table, we'll be able to see the common STI or the RTI syndromes. If somebody is suffering from genital ulcer, then there is a possibility that person may suffer from syphilis, chancroid, herpes, granuloma inguinal, or lymphogranuloma venereum. So all of these are sexually transmitted. But herpes simplex virus, being a viral infection, is actually not curable. Rest all are curable. So here also you can see, if a person comes with discharge, then the possible diagnosis can be bacterial vaginosis, can be yeast infections, can be because of the gonorrhea, chlamydia, trichomoniasis, and all of these are curable, because none of these are viral infections. But bacterial vaginosis and yeast infections are not sexually transmitted. Rest, gonorrhea, chlamydia, and trichomoniasis are sexually transmitted. Now, the patient can present with other symptoms like warts, that is caused by human papillomavirus, that's a viral infection that is also sexually transmitted, but once again, this is not curable. So now, we have completed the agent factors. Now we move on to the host factors. So mind it, sexually transmitted diseases mostly occurs in the young age group, that is more in 20 to 24 years age group, followed by 25 to 29 years age group, and then followed by 15 to 19 years age group. So most common it is observed in 20 to 24 years age group. Next is sex. Overall, morbidity rate is more in males than females, while the severity of morbidity is more in females than the males. So if we talk about the marital status, it has been seen that those who are single, divorced, separated persons, they have higher probability of suffering from sexually transmitted diseases rather than those who are married couples. Similarly, if you see in case of socioeconomic status, the individuals from the lowest socioeconomic groups have got a high morbidity. So next is the demographic and the social factors. Under the demographic factors, we can see that whenever there is an explosion, population explosion, then there is increase in the number of young people. So more there is the increase in number of young people, so they are more exposed to STDs. And the, with the increase in the population explosion, there are further rural to urban migration, the change in the lifestyles, and increased STD acquisition. Another important thing is that increasing educational opportunities for the women, they lead to delay in the marriage. And with this, there are further increase in the sexually transmitted disease risk. Next, we discuss about the social factors. So under social factors, there are various factors like prostitution. Now, prostitutes actually serves as the main reservoirs, but there is a general rule like demand supply is always there. So if prostituent is not there, the prostitutes is also not there. So both are important. And then this prostitution actually serves as easy money, and more so it is a reflection of poverty. The way the money is achieved through this way is almost impossible through any other modes. And if somebody has got broken homes, or somebody who has witnessed death in one or both the parents, or the separation between the parents, the child tries to seek for some other source of happiness, so is more predisposed to high risk behaviors. So if there are sexual disharmony between the couples, like separations, divorce, so this is also predispose the persons to some extra high risk behaviors. If there are wars, civil unrest, so there also there is an increased risk of transmission of the disease. So with the increase in the international travel, so there is increase in the spread of the disease. It can both import as well as export the disease, and it is also promoting the resistance of the organism, which is very well evident in case of Neisseria gonorrhoeae. And then the social stigma attached with the disease, because if somebody is stigmatized, the person generally tries to avoid this information or tries to hide it. So there is stigma, patient tries to drop out, tries to seek the treatment from the quacks. So there is incomplete treatment, and there is a further spread to the community. And if a person is alcoholic, then it's not a direct cause, actually it's an indirect cause. It's actually promotes prostitution. And changing behavioral patterns. So previously there was like traditional lifestyles, and now there are more sorts of independence, and so that is also promoting the high risk behaviors. The lifestyle patterns are changing. So STDs, there are increased risk to STDs. If there is increase in urbanization and industrialization, there are long working hours, we are away from the social or geographic, there is a social as well as geographic mobility, and there is a more and more involvement in the casual sex. So these all are the risk factors which leads or which predisposes to high-risk behaviors, and then leads to the STD risks. So now we will talk about the clinical spectrum. So this table we can see the important sexually transmitted pathogens and the diseases caused by them. I have also tried to show the drug of choice in the third column. So we know from our microbiology knowledge that Neisseria gonorrhoeae causes gonorrhea, urethritis, cervicitis, epididymitis, salpingitis, PID, and neonatal conjunctivitis. Treponema pallidum causes syphilis, Haemophilus dukeri causes chancroid, Chlamydia trachomatis causes lymphogranuloma venereum, cervicitis, proctitis, epididymitis, infant pneumonia, etc. And Klebsiella granulomatis causes donovanosis. Herpes simplex virus causes genital herpes. Hepatitis B virus can cause acute and chronic hepatitis. Human papillomavirus causes genital and anal warts. HIV can cause AIDS. Molluscum contagiosum causes genital molluscum contagiosum. And Candida albicans can cause vaginitis. Trichomonas vaginalis also causes vaginitis. So what we can see that the same symptom or the syndrome may be caused by more than one organism, and there can be the same drug which can act or cover more than one organism as well. And there are overlapping symptoms and there are overlapping drugs as well. So now we can see in the picture some of the signs of various sexually transmitted infections or the reported tract infections in women. So in this picture you can see the vesicles of the genital herpes. Here you can see the abrasions of intertrigo. Here you can see the herpetic ulcers in women. This picture you can see that the pus is pouring out of the endocervix in extensive mucopurulent cervicitis due to Chlamydia trachomatis infection. Here you can see growth of the genital warts. Here you can see chancre of the syphilis. Now the slide is showing some of the signs of various STI or RTI in men. So here you can see a discharge. So this is urethral discharge in a case of gonorrhea. Here you can see multiple ulcers. So these are herpetic ulcers in men. Here you can see multiple grouped erosions over the shaft of the penis. Here one can see the chancre of the glands in the syphilis. Here you can see chancre of coronal sulcus in syphilis. Here one can see the ulcer of the donovanosis. In this picture you can see condyloma lata in case of syphilis. Now these are certain pictures of anogenital warts. You can see the perivulval warts. This one is a picture of penile warts. Here you can see perianal warts. Now this is the picture of molluscum contagiosum. What you can see, this is the umbilication, the characteristic or the hallmark for the molluscum contagiosum. This is a picture of genital scabies. So now we'll discuss about the syndromic case management. Different agents cause sexually transmitted diseases with similar or overlapping clinical manifestations. It is very difficult to know exactly what organism is causing the syndrome, and the treatment may need to cover several possible infections. For example, genital ulcer disease or syndrome may be due to syphilis, chancroid, herpes simplex, etc. And another thing is that the mixed infections also occur very frequently in STI and RTI. Now the laboratory tests for the sexually transmitted diseases for diagnosis are often not available or are very costly. So they require resources, they add cost to the treatment, they may require the clients to make extra visits to the clinic, and they almost always result in the delays in treatment. So since 1990, WHO has recommended syndromic management of sexually transmitted diseases. So what is syndromic approach? The syndromic approach is a scientifically derived approach and offers accessible and immediate treatment that is effective and efficient. So the management of sexually transmitted infections using the flowchart is more cost effective than the diagnosis based on the laboratory tests. And ultimately, the management through this syndromic approach can actually or quickly render the patient non-infectious. So if you have understood what is the basis of syndromic case management, now we discuss about the basic essential steps of any STI or RTI syndromic case management. So the first one being from history taking, followed by clinical examination, whether it is a nital examination or oral examination or the anorectal examination apart from the general examinations. So this is followed by appropriate syndromic diagnosis using the flowcharts, followed by minimal laboratory tests wherever it is applicable, then providing the early and effective treatment, preferably single dose and directly observed, then the promotion and provision of the condoms, followed by the counseling for the behavior change and risk reduction, then referral for the syphilis screening and HIV counseling and testing, followed by the partner's notification and management, followed by follow-up of the patient as per the schedule, and ultimately documentation of each and every case details as well as the laboratory results. So we have discussed the essential steps. Now we move on to the syndromic management of urethral discharge or burning micturition in case of males. So you can see that the pus coming out is the gonococcal urethritis, inflamed meatus with the purulent discharge. The positive organisms can be Neisseria gonorrhoeae, Chlamydia trachomatis or Trichomonas vaginalis. There can be other organisms. So if a patient presents with urethral discharge, what we have to do, we have to take history, we have to assess the risk, and we have to do the examinations. So what history we will be taking? We will take the sexual exposure history, including whether there are any high risk practices like the orogenital sex in the previous 2 months, and ask whether there is any associated pain or burning sensation while passing urine, whether there is an increased frequency of urination. Then we have to assess the risk, whether there is history of recent unprotected sex, whether there was condom breakage or other issues in its usage, whether there are history of multiple sexual partners, whether there is a recent change in sexual partners, or whether the partner with symptoms suggestive of sexually transmitted infections in the recent past. So if you have taken the history, we have assessed the risk, now we will examine the patient. So if we have to look for whether there is a presence of redness and swelling of the urethral meatus, whether there is a discharge present, urethral discharge, and if the urethral discharge is not seen, gently massage the urethra from the ventral part of the penis towards the meatus and look for the thick, creamy, greenish, yellow or mucoid discharge. So lab investigations, if they are available, one can go for it. We go for the gram stain and we find the gram negative intracellular diplococci, and that's suggestive of gonorrhea. That is the negative diplococcus of the Neisseria gonorrhoeae. So NGU, non-gonococcal urethritis, you know, if you make the urethral smear and obtain from the sediment of the first void urine in case of non-gonococcal urethritis, you can expect more than 5 neutrophils per oil immersion field in the urethral smear, or you can see more than 10 neutrophils per high power field. You can go for the rapid plasma reagent test for the syphilis. You can refer the patient to ICTC for HIV counseling and testing. Then the treatment of the urethral discharge. So as dual infection is common, the treatment for the urethral discharge should adequately cover for both gonorrhea and chlamydial infections. What will you give? So we have to give cefixime 400 mg orally, single dose. Together with it, we have to add tablet azithromycin 1 gram orally, single dose under supervision. So it is cefixime 400 mg orally, single dose, combined with tablet azithromycin 1 gram orally, single dose, to cover both the gonorrhea as well as chlamydial infections. So next, is the syndrome specific guidelines for the partner management. So you have to track all the sexual partners of patients with urethral discharge whose last sexual contact with the patient was within 60 days, you have to find them, you have to evaluate, and you have to treat them in the same lines after ruling out the pregnancy and the history of allergy. One important thing is that during the treatment for the sexually transmitted diseases, you have to avoid the sex. So they should be advised for sexual abstinence during the course of treatment. So you have to ask the client to return after 7 days. And even when the symptoms persist beyond 7 days, you have to refer to the higher centers. Or you can think for trichomonas vaginalis. So you can give tablet secretinazole 2 grams orally, single dose. So if not responsive, so you send the patient to the higher center. Patient is allergic to azithromycin, you can give erythromycin 500 milligram 4 times daily for the 7 days. So now if the partner is pregnant, then what to do? So you have to give those drugs which are safe in pregnancy. So what we will be giving, cefixime or cephalosporins are generally safe. Cefixime is the same, cefixime 400 milligram orally single dose. You have an alternative options. You can give injection ceftriaxone 250 milligram intramuscular injections, and together with this you have to give azithromycin 1 gram stat orally. The other alternatives like erythromycin or amoxicillin in case of azithromycins. But mind it, in case of pregnancy you can never ever give quinolones. These are contraindicated. Even doxycycline, this is contraindicated in pregnancy. Next is follow-up. The patient has to be followed up after 7 days. You have to document whether there is any symptomatic cure. You have to document the test results for HIV and syphilis or hepatitis. And if there are symptoms are symptoms still are present, then you have to check for trichomonas infection. Give the treatment for trichomonas, that is secretinazole 2 grams orally. If the symptoms or signs persist, then you have to assess whether there is treatment failure or there is reinfections, and then approve advice for the prompt health. So we have completed the urethral discharge. Now we'll discuss about the vaginal discharge. So in this picture you can see the fruddy greenish vaginal discharge. This is seen in case of trichomoniasis. So in this slide you can see trichomonas. This is the trichomonas vaginalis. So here also you can see this curdy white precipitate or curdy white discharge. This is a candidiasis. So in the slides you can see the mycelia and the budding yeast suggestive of the candida. That is seen in case of 10% KOH progression. And this is in case of a bacterial vaginosis where the clusters are diagnostic. So how do we manage a case of vaginal discharge in females? So it could be because of vaginitis, it can be because of trichomoniasis, it can be because of cervical herpes, or it can be because of cervicitis. So we have to think in the line of vaginitis, so what could be the causative organisms, or we have to think in the line of cervicitis, like what could be the causative organism for cervicitis. In case of vaginitis, the causative organisms are Trichomonas vaginalis, Candida albicans, Gardnerella vaginalis, and Mycoplasma causing bacterial vaginosis. In case of cervicitis, the causative organisms can be Neisseria gonorrhoeae, Clamidia trachomatis, or they can be other organisms. So we will take the history. You take the menstrual history to rule out the pregnancy. We will take the history regarding the discharge, like what is the quantity, what is the smell, what is the color of the discharge, what is the consistency, whether it is associated with any genital itching, whether there is any burning sensation while passing urine, whether there is increased frequency of urination, whether there is any ulcer or swelling on the vulval or inguinal region, whether there is any associated low backache, or whether there are problems or symptoms in the sexual partner. After taking the history, we will go for the per speculum examinations. So we have to look for whether there is a vaginitis or cervicitis. So in case of vaginitis, if you think of trichomoniasis, so there is possibility of greenish fruddy discharge. In case of candidiasis, we can see curdy white discharge. So if cervicitis is likely, then you will find cervical eruption, cervical ulcer, or you will get the cervical discharge. Mind it, you have to also do the bimanual pelvic examination to rule out pelvic inflammatory disease. So if the patient is too much hesitant the examination or is resistant or not cooperating towards speculum examination, then you have to treat for both vaginitis as well as cervicitis. And if the lab investigations available, you have to do the lab investigations like wet mount microscopy for the discharge, wet mount microscopy of discharge for Trichomonas vaginalis to look for the cluses, and 10% cure preparations for Candida albicans and gram stain for detecting gonococci. Next is the treatment of the vaginal discharge. So treatment in line of vaginitis, in line of cervicitis. So vaginitis, give tablet secundazole 2 gram orally single dose, or alternatively you can give tinidazole 500 milligram orally twice daily for 5 days. If there is vomiting, you can give metoclopramide 30 minutes before. And candidiasis, you can give fluconazole 150 mg orally single dose, or clotrimazole pessary may be used 500 mg once. So it is tablet secundazole 2 gram orally single dose with fluconazole 150 mg orally single dose. So in case of cervicitis, you have to treat chlamydia and gonorrhea. So what we have to give? We have to give tablet cefixime 400 mg orally single dose, and we have together with it to cover chlamydia, we have to give azithromycin 1 gram. So mind it, after treatment, we have to go for the management of the pregnant women. We have to consider those drugs which are safer. So if the patient is in first trimester, we don't go for the fluconazole, but orally, but we go for the local pessary, vaginal pessary of clotrimazole. And we can also use metronidazole pessaries intravaginally if trichomoniasis or bacterial vaginosis is suspected. If the patient is in second or third trimester, we can give oral imidazoles. Mind aid for candidiasis and bacterial vaginosis, syndrome-specific partner management is not needed. But if the patient is suffering from trichomoniasis or we suspect that, then we have to treat all the sexual partners in the last 30 days in the same line of treatment, and the remaining is the same. Just like you have to avoid the sexual acts, you have to avoid the sex and provide the condoms adequate and schedule the return visits after 7 days. So we have finished genital ulcer, syndromic case management. We have talked about vaginal discharge. Now we will discuss about the management of the genital ulcers. So you can see this is a syphilis. This is of herpes genitalis. So it can be because of herpetic conditions, the genital herpes, or it can be non-herpetic, can be because of syphilis or chancroid. So the causative organisms, Treponema pallida, Haemophilus Dupree, Klebsiella granulomatis, Chlamydia trachomatis, and herpes simplex. So once again, you have to take the history regarding the ulcer, whether there are any vesicles, whether there are any burning sensation in the genital region, whether there are sexual exposure of either partner, including the high-risk practices like the orogenital sex. Now look for the presence of, now go for the examinations, look for the presence of vesicles, whether there are the presence of genital ulcer, whether they are single or multiple. So look for the inguinal lymph nodes, whether they are swollen. So if it is swollen, then go for the respective flowchart. Look for the characteristic of the ulcer, whether they are painful. So if it is painful, if it is single or multiple, you're getting painful vesicles ulcer, it is suggestive of herpes simplex. So if you're getting painful ulcers but they are singles, then it is more likely to be case of chancroid. The painless ulcer with firm or shorty lymph nodes, it is likely to be syphilis. But if you get painless ulcer with inguinal lymph node, so that could be because of granuloma inguinale or lymphogranuloma venereum. So investigations, gram stain or RPR or ICTC, or you can refer to higher centers. So how do you treat case of genital ulcer? So if you think of herpes, so if there are vesicles which are multiple, or you can get, or you are getting multiple painful ulcers, you think of a herpes, treat the patient with tablet cyclovir 400 milligram 3 times daily for 7 days. But if you see only ulcer is present, then you have to think in the line of syphilis and chancroid. Then you have to give injection benzathine penicillin, that is 2.4 million international units intramuscular single dose. Along with it, you have to give azithromycin 1 gram orally to cover the chancroid. Those who are allergic to penicillin, you can consider for erythromycin or doxycycline. So the part-time management, you have to remember that in case of genital ulcer, you have to go for the partner management for all those contacts in the last 3 months. And the remaining are similar. As far as the management of pregnant patient is concerned, you have to give the safe drugs. The injection benzathine penicillin is quite safe. You can give erythromycin, those who are allergic. Mind it, only erythromycin base or erythromycin ethyl succinate preparations are used in pregnancy, not the estolate. So now we move to the management of lower abdominal pain in females. So we are thinking of pelvic inflammatory disease. So lower abdominal pain syndrome comprises of a spectrum of inflammatory disorders of the upper genital tract, including any combination of endometritis, salpingitis, tubo-ovarian abscess, and pelvic peritonitis. The causative organisms can be Neisseria gonorrhoeae, Chlamydia trachomatis, Mycoplasma, Gardnerella, and anaerobic bacteria. So we have to take the history that whether there are associated fever, whether there is vaginal discharge, what about the menstrual history, whether there are any irregular bleeding, whether there is dysmenorrhea, whether there is history of dyspareunia, whether there is dysuria, tenesmus, low backache, or whether there is history of any contraceptive use like intrauterine devices. Once we have taken the history, now we proceed to examination of the patient. So go for the general examination, examine the temperature, pulse, blood pressure. After doing the general examination, go for the per speculum examination. So see whether there is any congestion or any ulceration, or whether there is any discharge. Do the per abdominal examination. If there is a lower abdominal tenderness or guarding, then PID is more likely. And pelvic examination, you will get cervical motion tenderness. So laboratory investigations, you have to go for the wet smear, gram stain, complete blood count, urine microscopy for pulses, RPR, ICTC for HIV counting and testings. Next is the treatment of pelvic inflammatory disease. So mind it, pelvic inflammatory disease is a serious condition. So if the patient is mild or moderate, suffering from mild or moderate pelvic inflammatory disease, only then we can think of outpatient treatment. Otherwise, the patient has to be admitted. So therapy is directed towards Neisseria gonorrhoeae and Chlamydia trachomatis and anaerobes. So what we give? We give tablet cefixime 400 mg orally twice daily for 7 days. To this we combine tablet metronidazole 400 mg orally twice daily for 14 days. And we give capsule doxycycline 100 mg orally twice daily for 14 days. To treat the chlamydial infection. So if there is pain, we can give ibuprofen and ibuprofen, and we can give ranitidine for to prevent the gastritis. If there are any intrauterine devices, it has to be removed under the antibiotic coverage, and you have to observe after 3 days, because if there is no improvement, then please refer for the inpatient treatment. So what is the drug? It is cefixime 400 mg orally twice daily for 7 days, plus metronidazole orally 400 mg orally twice daily for 14 days, plus doxycycline 100 mg orally twice daily for 14 days in case of pelvic inflammatory disease. So the syndrome specific guidelines for the partner management, you have to treat all the patients, all the partners who came in contact in the last 2 months, and remaining are mostly similar, but only thing is follow up has to be done in 3rd day, 7th day and 14th day. The pregnant woman, if a pregnant woman is suffering from PID, this is actually very rare, but if it occurs, then don't go for the outpatient treatment, better refer to the higher center for admissions. So next we proceed to the management of the scrotal swelling. Scrotal swelling organisms can be, if we think of infectious causes, so it can be STI related causes like Neisseria gonorrhoeae, Chlamydia trachomatis, and non-STI causes like tuberculosis, filariasis, coliforms, pseudomonas, mumps, virus infections. So scrotal swelling can also be because of certain non-infectious causes like trauma, hematoma, and torsion. We have to take the history, whether there is any swelling and pain in the scrotum, whether there is pain or burning sensation while passing urine, whether there is any urethral discharge, and whether there is any symptomatic symptoms like malaise, fever, etc. We have to examine for the presence of redness and edema of the overlying skin, and whether the temperature is raised, whether there is any tenderness, whether there are associated urethral discharge or genital ulcers, and we have to also do the transillumination test to rule out the hydrocele. Then we have to go for the laboratory investigations for the gonococcal, for the gram stain, and we have to go for the urethral smear RPR test and refer to ICTC for HIV counseling and testing. So how do we treat a case of scrotal swelling? So a dual infection is likely. Treat in the line of gonorrhea and chlamydial infections. So that we already discussed, that is cefixime 400 mg orally single dose plus azithromycin 1 gram orally single dose under supervision, and ask the client to return after 7 days of therapy. Mind you, this painful scrotal swelling is actually very painful. So you have to give the supportive therapy to reduce the pain like bed rest, scrotal support, the T-bandage and analgesics. If you do not give quick and effective therapy, then there can be damage of the testicular tissues and that may result into subfertility. You have to go for the partner management. You have to treat all the partners within the last 60 days of exposures, and these are the similar to others. And the pregnant partners, you have to give the drugs which are safer in pregnancy, like cefixime, injection ceftriaxone, erythromycin, amoxicillin, azithromycin. So most of the syndromic case managements we have already discussed, but this is your self-study. You will read it from the books, that is the management of the inguinal bevo. This is also important. And you will also read management of the oral and anal sexually transmitted infections and other conditions from the books. So I'm just telling you that inguinal bevo, the treatment is actually for 21 days. You have to give capsule doxycycline 100 mg twice daily for 21 days, and to this you have to add azithromycin 1 gram orally single dose. So this you will do the self study. So these are the color coded kits for STI or RTI kits. You will be able to see this in your practical classes. So these are the color coded kits. You can see kit 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, the gray color, green, white, blue, red, yellow, and the black colored kits for the different syndromic case managements. So, kit 1 is used for urethral discharge, anorectal discharge, cervicitis, cervical discharge, painful scrotal swelling, or presumptive treatment. You know, under this, we have azithromycin, 1 gram orally, this under this bracket, it is 1 tablet, number of tablets. The quantity has been represented in the bracket. So, azithromycin, 1 gram orally single dose, combined with tablet cefixime, 400 mg orally single dose. Kit 2 is green colored. It is meant for vaginitis or vaginal discharge. You have to give tablet secnidazole, 2 gram orally single dose, combined with fluconazole, 150 mg orally single dose. Kit 3 is white colored. It is for genital ulcerative disease, non-herpetic. So you have to give injection benzathine penicillin 2.4 million units. Along with it, you have to give azithromycin 1 gram orally single dose. Along with it, it is provided with disposable syringe and sterile water and needle. The blue colored kit is the kit 4 for the genital ulcer disease, non-herpetic, for those patients who are allergic to penicillin. So under this, the tablet doxycycline 100 mg twice daily has to be taken for 15 days, and tablet azithromycin has to be taken 1 gram orally single dose. The next is the red colored kit, which is kit 5, that is genital ulcerative disease, herpetic. ट्रीटमेंट इज साइक्लोविन 400 मिलीग्राम ओरली थ्राइस डेली फॉर 7 डेज. सो 21 टैबलेट्स आर प्रोवाइडेड. द येलो कलर्ड किट और द किट 6 इज फॉर ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ लोअर एब्डोमिनल पेन और पेल्विक इन्फ्लेमेटरी डिजीज. अंडर दिस द टैबलेट सफिक्स सेम 400 मिलीग्राम ओरली सिंगल डोज इज कंबाइंड विद टैबलेट मेट्रोनिडाजोल 400 मिलीग्राम ओरली ट्वाइस डेली फॉर 14 डेज. सो 28 टैबलेट्स आर प्रोवाइडेड. एंड कैप्सूल डॉक्सीसाइक्लिन 100 मिलीग्राम ओरली ट्वाइस डेली फॉर 14 डेज. दैट इज व्हाई 28 टैबलेट्स आर प्रोवाइडेड. सो दिस इज गिवन इन केस ऑफ लोअर एब्डोमिनल पेन और पेल्विक इन्फ्लेमेटरी डिजीज. Then the last one is the black colored kit, that is the kit 7, which is given in case of inguinal bubo, and it consists of tablet doxycycline 100 milligram that has to be taken twice daily for 21 days, and that has to be combined with tablet azithromycin 1 gram orally single dose. So now we discuss about the control of sexually transmitted diseases. Sexually transmitted diseases can be, the control can be discussed under four headings, that is initial planning, then the different intervention strategies, the support components, and the monitoring and evaluates. So under the initial planning, like any other planning cycle, we have to first define the problems, we have to establish the priorities, set the objectives, and consider different strategies. So initial planning, it has to be done. First of all, the problem definition has to be done in terms of the prevalence of the disease or what are the psychosocial and other health effects that can be done by the sero epidemiological and the population surveys. So we have to establish the priorities because our resources are always limited, and based on how much is the problem, we have to decide what all things we will actually prioritize. So that is establishing priorities. And setting the objectives. The objectives must be quantifiable, must be measurable, and must be achievable, and it should be non-ambiguous. So after setting the objectives, we have to go for the consideration of different strategies. So what are the intervention strategies? We have the detection of the cases that can be done by screening, contact tracing, cluster testing, and case holding and treatment, epidemiological treatment, personal prophylaxis by contraceptives and vaccines, and provision of health education. So how do we do the case detection? That can be done by the screening of the healthy volunteers from the general populations who are tested for the early detection of the disease, and the high priority groups like the pregnant women, blood donors, industrial workers, the high risk groups or the prostitutes, restaurants and hotel staffs can be screened for the disease. Then is the contact tracing. In this, we try to trace the sexual partners of the diagnosed patients. Yes, and we try to identify them, locate them, investigate, and treat them. Then is the cluster testing. The patients are actually asked to name the other persons of either sex who move in the same socio-sexual environment. That is what we mean by cluster testing. The next is the case holding and treatment. So that means we have to provide the adequate treatment for the patients as well as their contacts, because there is a stigma attached with the disease. There is high probability of dropout. So we have to ensure that we provide complete and adequate treatment. There is the epidemiological treatment. Those who are recently exposed to sexually transmitted diseases are administered with the full therapeutic dose without waiting for the lab results. And not only that, we give the full therapeutic dose, we also do the venereological examination and the contact tracing, that is epidemiological treatment or the contact treatment. Next is the personal prophylaxis. The promotion and provision of the condoms is the male condom and the female condom, and that is should be used in addition to the spermicides. So this is actually increases the effectiveness and it minimizes the risk of sexually transmitted diseases. Then is the health education regarding the high-risk behaviors to the high-risk groups or even the general public or the patients. So then there are certain support components like the opening of the STD clinics, the bandit under the Suraksha clinic. You might have come across the Suraksha clinic multiple places. So these are actually the sexual and reproductive health services or the STD clinics. And they can be laboratory services, primary healthcare information, primary healthcare information system, legislation, social welfare measures. And finally, for the control of STD, we have to go for the monitoring of the disease trends, and we have to evaluate the program activities to know that how effective are the intervention strategies. So now we will discuss about the national program which is linked with the sexually transmitted diseases. So the National Sexually Transmitted Disease Control Program in India was launched or was started in India in the year 1946. Now we know that if a person is actually suffering from sexually transmitted infection, then the person is also more prone to acquire HIV because of the similar high risk behavior, as well as there is a breach in the mucosa that leads to rapid spread of the disease. So in view of the strong relationship between RTI and STI and HIV, the National Sexually Transmitted Disease Control Program has been merged with National AIDS Control Program since the year 1992. NACP actually came in the year 1987. In 1992, the National AIDS Control Project Phase 1 was launched in the year 1992, and it was in this year when National STD Control Program was merged with National AIDS Control Program. So the name of the national program now we have is National AIDS Control Program, Control of Reproductive Tract Infection, including the sexually transmitted infections. The general strategies being the provision of standardized RTI or STI management to the general population, to the high-risk groups, and the provision of laboratory support for diagnosis and surveillance of STI or RTI. So now we will discuss about the National Strategic Plan for HIV or AIDS and Sexually Transmitted Infections 2017 to 2024. Mind it, this strategy plans is for a vision of AIDS in India, because if there is STD, it increases the risk of HIV acquisition. So mainly under this strategic plan, so what are the particular strategies that are targeted towards prevention and control of STI, RTI are broadly categorized into two categories. That is A, strengthening the STI or RTI control and prevention, means whatever is there, we will strengthen the schemes. And the second one is the elimination of parent to child transmission of HIV and syphilis. So let's look onto the what are the strategies under the this strengthening the STI-RTI control. So comprehensive services as a part of the sexual and reproductive health umbrella, partnership with the public sector and private sector, standardized service package for at-risk population through flexible service delivery approach, strengthening the laboratory support for etiological diagnosis and surveillance, and strengthening the information system. With regards to elimination of parent-to-child transmission of HIV and syphilis, is the strategy is being bridging the testing gap for HIV and syphilis among the pregnant women, providing universal access to antiretroviral therapy and syphilis treatment to those who are positive. Then strengthening the follow-ups and uptake of the early infant diagnosis, and then improve linkage with the National Health Mission. So now we will discuss about the elimination of parent to child transmission, that is called as EPTCT, elimination of parent to child transmission of syphilis. The goal of EPTCT is to eliminate parent to child transmission by the year 2017. And the target is to reduce the incidence of congenital syphilis to less than 0.3 cases per 1000 live births by the year 2017. So under this, there are five objectives. The first one is to ensure the universal and early registration of pregnant women at first antenatal care visit in first trimester, to ensure early screening of pregnant women for HIV and syphilis, to identify and provide prompt treatment to to all seroreactive pregnant women to promote the institutional delivery and to follow up the newborn till 18 months of age. So remember, the management in case of maternal syphilis or congenital syphilis is the same drug, that is the benzathine penicillin G. Only the dose may vary. So in case of maternal syphilis, if the patient presents in the early stage, you have to give a single dose of 2.4 million international units through the intramuscular route. But if the patient presents in the later stage, then one has to give weekly 2.4 million international units of benzathine penicillin G intramuscularly for 3 weeks. So congenital syphilis, prophylactically, we can give single dose of 50,000 units per kilogram body weight through the intramuscular route to the baby, and for the curative purpose, we can give the benzathine penicillin G 50,000 units per kilogram body weight intramuscularly daily for 10 days, or we can give aqueous crystalline penicillin G IV 50,000 units per kilogram 12 hourly for the first 7 days, followed by every 8 hours for the 3 days. So mind it, whether it is maternal syphilis or it is congenital syphilis, the drug is the same, that is penicillin. So now let us sum up what we have discussed. We have discussed that the term STI, RTI, STD are all different. Not all sexually transmitted infections are reproductive tract infections, and not all reproductive tract infections are sexually tract infections, and not all sexually tract infections may lead to sexually transmitted diseases. Then we discuss that syndromic case management of sexually transmitted diseases or infections using the flowchart is very cost effective, efficient, and it provides immediate lab treatment without awaiting the lab results. And we finally discussed under the national strategy for HIV AIDS and STI control 2017 to 2024, that is, to have a vision of AIDS free India, we need to strengthen the STI RTI prevention and control, as well as prevent the parent to child transmission of HIV and syphilis. So better to protect rather than regret. And we discuss that STDs can be prevented if you talk, test, and treat. So that's all for today's class. Thank you.